Hi, everybody. My name's Alan. On behalf of the crew, I'd like to welcome you to another edition of Bridging Heaven and Earth. You know, I think that, you know, for most of us, I mean, most of you know that, you know, because of the International Healing Art Project Bridging does and the shows that are all over the world and the, you know, the internet connections all over the world, that we're in touch with literally thousands and thousands of people every week from all over the world. And we're seeing that these are extraordinary times in so many ways. Extraordinary times in that people are having just such powerful and mind-opening and heart-opening experiences. And so many people from all over the globe are just coming into a recognition of their fullness and their oneness and their love and their connection. And yet on the other side of that, in a certain way, or not that I even have sides, but that there is a certain trauma happening for people, a certain growth spurts, a certain changing, rapid change, a certain experience that the ground is shaking under their feet, that the institutions and the concepts and the ways of being and just a lot of the things that people counted on to be there in a certain way are rapidly changing, are breaking down, are going through tremendous transmuting and transformation. And as a human species, this is an extraordinarily interesting and dynamic time for us. And, you know, the question is, how do we best travel? How do we best traverse? How do we best come into that recognition of our oneness, of our love, our connectedness? To go from fear to love, to go from separation into an experience of our connectedness, our oneness. What is our path to that? What is our way? And if the old ways of being and the old, in a sense, the old tools and the old ways of experiencing our lives and our identities here are breaking down, how do we come into this new world in a way? The same world, but that new recognition, that new experience, that new vibration, the vibration of love, the vibration of connection, the vibration of the infinite, the vibration of inclusion. And how do we, with the breakdown of old paradigms on the bridge between heaven and earth, metaphorically, how do we build those new paradigms joyously and lovingly, together, creatively? And it's, you know, it's a curious time and it's an interesting time for us to come into that. And how can we do it with as little as ego as possible? I mean, I have this expression I tell people, if the infinite wasn't infinite, the ego would be infinite, because it's a tricky balance here. To recognize yourself in a separate human body and recognize yourself as the Father and I, the Goddess and I are one. That we are all connected, that we are all part of that infinite energy, that we all are that infinite energy. And so that's what our process is now. That is what all of us who have recognized that to any extent are in the process of doing, is day to day, breath by breath, building a new world, building new paradigms, building new ways of relating, literally in every way. And in a certain sense, it's tricky business. You know, it's tricky. Almost our DNA, almost our body, almost our whole being is changing to take in this more light, this more recognition, this more realization. And there are people literally from all over the world who've dedicated their lives to building these new ways of being, to building these new paradigms, to building this bridge between heaven and earth for all of us. And tonight's guest, Ellen Watson, is one of those master teachers, one of those people whose life is dedicated to that service, to serve that bridge, to serve those new paradigms, to serve that ease of change, to serve the grace of change, to serve the beauty and the simplicity of coming into that love. She's a longtime teacher of Esalen massage, of spirit dance, of Gabriel Ross' five rhythms, holotropic breathwork, the art of essential touch, and your body is a musical instrument. I mean, just using touch and movement to heal the body, mind, and spirit, to bring us through this change period, through this transformation into love, joyously and lovingly and gracefully. And she travels the world teaching and healing and basically just vibrating love, vibrating that infinite, vibrating that inclusion to help us all in this process of growth, in this process of transformation. You know, and as most of you know, we usually show videos, and tonight we have a beautiful, two parts of a beautiful video of an Indonesian Esalen massage training video that Ellen did that was shot by one of the bridging crew, the beloved Bianca, who was one of the students at that training session in Indonesia. And she shot some beautiful footage. I'm going to show two parts of that. The first one is more of massage. The second part is more about movement. And as most of you know, we're also in the middle of an extraordinarily powerful and beautiful and growing and infinite and inclusive international healing art project that came as a dream, it came as a vision, as an acupuncture, as a healing of the heart of the planet, and that we would reach out with the bridging production, with the bridging distribution system through cable television, through the internet, through Sky Channel satellite in Europe, and say anybody who wants to produce a new original piece based on the theme Bridging Heaven and Earth, get it to us, any size, any format, any skill level. Get it to us here and we'll put it on the show. We'll have art project shows. We've already done 6 art project shows where we only showed art. If you want to, go to heaventoearthart.com and go watch these shows and you'll see just piece after piece and text and poetry that people have sent in accompanying them. And literally we've received over 370 pieces from all over the world. All different sizes, all different formats, all different shapes, literally from the ages of 2 to 92, and skill levels of the most world-renowned artists to people who aren't considered artists or consider themselves artists, who bought Sharpie markers because they wanted to be part of the creativity, wanted to be part of the healing, the collaboration. And everyone is welcome. The more people involved, the better the healing, the better the acupuncture for the planet. So everyone is welcome to join us. And tonight we have a beautiful photograph that Ellen did, our guest tonight, Ellen Watson. And Bianca as well has produced a beautiful stained glass piece that is just magnificent. And literally, if you go to Heaven to Earth Art and just go through page after page after page, it will literally blow your mind, blow your heart, because they're so beautiful. All new original pieces based on the theme Bridging Heaven and Earth. All right, so now join me in a short meditation, then we'll have this beautiful Indonesia video, and then we'll have art, music, and Ellen with us. So join me in a short meditation. Thank you. So now we're going to see the massage part of the Indonesian Esalen massage training video done by Bianca and featuring Ellen Watson, tonight's guest. So enjoy.
So one thing I noticed in the massages that I received and I think was the style and stroke was that my feet on the upstroke were frequently not touched. But it started somewhere in the ankle of the leg. And I also noticed that there was a very nice contact on the downstroke of my foot. I liked, I didn't get quite enough hand. What you did do, those of you who focused on hand for a moment, I like them, but I will say again, and I know when you have a limited time and you're attempting to give a full body massage, that spending time on the hand seems, I can't do that. If you'll use a clock and time yourself and just not let your mind tell you you have to do something else, and focus, and when we say the hand, you can focus on the body, all the things that make it possible for the hand to do what it does. Forward knee, right? And then rolling her into me, using her safety. And then I have access.
Hi, everybody. Welcome back. So that was a beautiful video. That was Ellen doing massage in Indonesia, taken by Bianca, who is a student at this professional certification training session that was taking place there in Bali, Indonesia. And the extraordinary piece of art, photograph, healing art that you see in between Ellen and I was taken by Ellen Sunset at Mimpi. Why don't you talk about what that means to you and how you took it and just the whole thing about it.
Well, Mimpi is one of those places on this planet where heaven and earth come together often, and especially at sunset. The restaurant is in the foreground here, which you can't see. So whenever we walk down to this place, we have a different experience. And this particular day, as you can see, was cloudy, and there was more of a golden hue. Some days it's the same color as my blouse. Some days it's overcast with coastal fog, and so there's almost no sunset. But the rhythms that I find there with the boats, these are all the boats that take people out on the reef. This is the highest volcano on the island of Java, which is 70 nautical miles to the east. And then these are two of the other non-active volcanoes. So when I look out over this expanse, whether it's morning, noon, or sunset, my heart opens, I take a deep breath, and I feel in communion with all that is. So this is one of those places on the planet for me and for most people who visit there, where heaven and earth come together.
Wow, beautiful. And when did you... Was it early on in your life that you had this sense that you were going to be doing service and healing the heart through movement and through dance and through massage? I mean, when did that become something that, or did it evolve?
It evolved. In my earlier years, I was in business. I had retail businesses, an importing company. I worked on Wall Street. And I worked for a brokerage house in Texas in the financial markets. And only after going to Esalen Institute in Big Sur in the early 80s, when I needed healing from everything, all the things that had taken place in my earlier life. I'd had three marriages and
two had ended in death of my husbands, and one, a man realized he was gay. So my marriage experience had been sort of dramatic and traumatic, and then I came from a challenging family background. So I went to Esalen exhausted at 36 and had needed everything that was offered there, healing of every type. And in healing myself, I found such pleasure and such renewed vigor and vitality and a whole new way of looking at the world and being in the world through movement and touch, through breath, through discovering my own breath and how to use it well, that eventually I realized I was moving into this as a profession, not just for my own healing.
Almost like this is a destiny, this is a service, this is my life's work, play, mm-hmm. however you would.
Yeah, nothing else had felt quite a fit. While things interested me intellectually, they weren't a soul level. I was quite active in a church in my 20s, and service was an important part of that. And that felt real. That felt good. Now I've found a way to combine it.
And so how did that progress from you being healed and coming in contact with all these healing modalities and these teachers and workshops for you to move into wanting to make that your service?
Well, part of it was pragmatics. I had a certain amount of money to educate myself and use for healing when I arrived at Esalen, and then after 4 years, I needed to do something. And I either needed to leave and re-enter the world of work in a different way, or I needed to stay there and find something in my skill set that served the Institute. So I left for about a year and found that I didn't really want to go back to what I had been doing. And I didn't want to re-enter the world with someone else, even in a new way. I really wanted to be involved in the communal aspect of Esalen, living on a land with a group of people. And I liked this new work that I was doing. It had more substance.
And this new work was massage, Esalen massage?
Yeah, I was practicing massage, and I was facilitating a form of breath work, which activates the chakra or the energy system in the body. And through using evocative music from other cultures and activating breath purposefully and in an extended period of time, doorways opened to the psyche, to the mind, to the body that weren't normally open in a day-to-day life. And facilitating those day-long experiences or weekend or month-long experiences fed me. Those experiences opened me in countless ways. Consciousness, a new paradigm. I felt like in those years where I lived on campus at Esalen.
At Esalen, uh-huh.
Yeah, that I had death rebirth experiences on a regular basis. And as I let go of one way of looking and feeling and being, another opened. And that I was able to take these steps as if through doorways.
And almost more, each one more expansive.
Yes, than the next. Rarely was there backtracking. Uh-huh. That it was a series of these portals opening. And so that was so attractive that I wanted to go back and continue that process. So I spent 10 years, basically, with that 1 year off. Education and experiential education, building a framework for what I do now that was both healing for me and educational. 80% experiential, 20% didactic or information, I'd say was true at the time of every program that we led there. So I learned to facilitate what I do now through the path of direct experience.
And why don't you talk to people about how, and you know, what are the, you know, I listed a bunch of the different
right.
modalities and techniques and tools that you use. Why don't you, you know, kind of go
talk
through
about
them
that
and,
a little bit. Well, I think what links all of those, one is breath, that breath, the word for breath in most languages is synonymous with spirit. So the same word for spirit involves inspiration or breathing in, that we actually take in the essence of spirit through the simple act of breathing. And while that may be something that everyone knows, for me it was profound. I had never.
I don't think everybody really knows.
I'd never.
Not even yet. Okay. I don't think it's still a somewhat of a mystery that it's so simple in a way.
My first year, year and a half was discovering breath in everything that I did, and in all of the practices that I teach now, the meditation I call what I do moving meditation practice. Breath is how we begin, paying attention, learning to track and follow breath in and out of the body. And whether if we heighten the number of inhalations we do per minute, breathing rapidly, and breathe out rapidly, then we build a charge. It's called an energetic charge. And so we have more energy moving through the system. And more doors can open that way. So I'd say my first year and a half or 2 years were really spent falling in love with breath. And then the various therapeutic models that were present on the land at that time. Some of the greats out in the world today were still scholars in residence at Esalen. And so I got to sit at their feet and learn from them. So whether it was learning to touch another person through the largest organ in the body, the skin, and do so with presence, enlivened and energized through awareness of breath, and then pleasure at the feet of a Benedictine monk who is one of the world's most highly regarded spiritual teachers today, Brother David Steindl-Rast, who now has his own program called gratefulness.org. He was our teacher in residence at Esalen, so I could be with him all the time. And I learned about pleasure of the senses, that we were designed by the Great One, by the Oneness, by our Creator, to experience pleasure through alive and engaged senses. Certainly the five senses, the sixth sense, and however many other senses that we may not be aware of. And that somehow, in my background, that was not emphasized. It was actually asceticism. Denial of pleasure was actually more the norm. So whether it was childlike pleasure at dancing and spinning around in the grass and falling down and laughing, the return of laughter as a viable means for waking
joy.
Up,
joy.
Pure, unbridled joy. Mm. So that, I'd say, because Esalen is a community and it's on a very small piece of land, relatively speaking, that hugs the coastline, but it's because it hugs the coastline, it's long. So there's a greater sense of spaciousness because it's got the Pacific Ocean at its boundary, that I felt like I had freedom to be me and freedom to explore in a way that I had never had in my life.
And that was from the very beginning, in a certain sense, that was the intention of Esalen, to create that energetic field where people could feel free and safe enough to grow and experience these opening portals.
Right. Well, it was certainly a success with me. I felt it from the day I walked onto the land and still feel it today when I walk back. During the course of being there so long, which is now 30 years, in association with it, there have been times when I was in administration and things were tough. At the time, just like any organization goes through expansion and contraction and challenging moments, there are times when I felt like I had to run up the hill to feel free. But as a general rule, that piece of land supports this.
And so your journey continued from experiencing what breath can do to what touch can do and what movement can do. And why don't you continue how that led all over the world and led to...
Right. Well, one thing I didn't mention that's really important to include is music. That in everything I do, music is an important part. The vibration of sound, whether it comes from the human voice, a cappella, singing or just sounding, or whether it comes from musicians who listen to each other and make sound for people to move to or breathe to. So music and music of the ocean. The rhythms of the mighty Pacific has, and the birds. So I fell in love with sound. And so sound, touch, breath, movement, all of those interweave in the practices that have drawn me closest. So as a student, ongoing student, I was nonstop. There were no degrees available in any of the practices that I studied at the time. So I'm not a degreed person, but I pursued them as if it were. And after 10 years, I felt ready to move out into the world and had a number of invitations to teach. First, I spent 5 or 6 years teaching actively in Europe, Switzerland and Germany particularly, Greece, Italy, France, the Netherlands, the UK. And so I got to see some of my cultural heritage, some of the Western, the development of Western history, which was extremely meaningful, deepening for me. And so I got to see that part of the world as I worked. And then because I needed to supplement my income, I got interested in fabric from Indonesia and began importing sarongs and tapestries. And eventually I was invited to go there and teach by someone. And once I landed there and experienced the culture, particularly of Bali, where this photograph was taken, I fell in love with the people and the way they are with their families, the way they are with each other, the way their culture welcomes people. And while they're considered primarily Hindu now, until they were required by the government to choose a religion, they considered water their god, that the whole island existed because of water and had such abundant water, and that their crops grew in water, rice and lotus. The Balinese, before rice was cultivated there, are known to have eaten lotus flowers and the pods, and that it has an extraordinary energy. So water is revered, that many of their temples, I'll just say most of their temples, the element of water is quite visible and highly respected. So I fell in love with Bali and the people. And one of the sayings I like a lot is, you'll find your work where your deep passion meets the world's deep need. And while Bali is well known for tourism and I think is a popular destination for weddings, for shopping, I think people like to go there because of the favorable prices in most economies or the exchange rate, that what happens to local people is they frequently are left out of this equation. And so they need a lot of support, education in speaking English or basic health care. So I found a need for my interest in service in vocational education for local people, bringing people from my international network there and combining for a multicultural experience that bridged socioeconomic difference, that through the medium of touch, breath, sound, song, learning others, chants, that preconceived notions about what people from the West were like, or people from the East were like, or from a developing country, were dispelled through the path of direct experience. So in a very small way, we have been able to serve local people who don't get much education, formal education, and improve their ability to earn income. And my goal in this program I've been working with for the last, intensively for the last 4 years at this place called Mimpi, is to empower the employees there, especially those in guest services in the spa and in the wellness programming, that they will be trained so well that they won't need me anymore. And then people can go there and learn from the local people.
And so you're in the process of teaching these people who live in this area the skill set that you have, and bringing that energy so that they will be able to run the workshops and run the teaching mm-hmm. sessions.
Mm-hmm. I'll say once the time, my vision and my belief is that it'll take about 10 years, and I started 4 years ago. So we're not quite halfway into the program.
And people there are really excited and
so far,
energetic about wanting to learn and wanting to be part
it's
of it.
It's growing. The interest is growing. And water being one of the elements that's challenging around the planet today, who has it, who has access to it, and how it's available. And this particular piece of property has hot springs, thermal water that both bathes people and can be drunk for healing. It's alkaline and it's pH. So it's how to share it with the local people. Is there enough for the local people because they don't have access? There's no rainwater catchment device and there's no fresh running water. So this is an ongoing project between Mimpi and the people, the family that owns Mimpi, and me, and then the local people, is how to enrich everybody's life so that there's not the usual haves and have-nots. So yes, everybody's more and more enthusiastic. It's taken a few years to build rapport, establish trust that we're the good guys, we're part of the solution.
We mean well.
Yeah, and we're not part of the problem. We're not coming in to take over and remove them from what sustains them.
Oh, beautiful. All right, maybe we'll talk a little more about that, and we'll watch the second half of that beautiful video from here.
Okay.
The one Bianca did from, this is the Indonesian Esalen massage training video, and this part is focusing on what Ellen was talking about, movement and dance and the ecstatic experience that could be gotten from that. So enjoy.
Happy legs. This little walk is a happy walk. These little ankles girls are happy and go. These little girls are happy and go. These little feet are happy feet. Happy feet.
Her moving meditation practices are so powerful. At the end of each day, we're just so energized and glowing and enlightened.
Hi everybody, welcome back. So very beautiful video. That was the movement and dance section. And now the beautiful art piece you're seeing, the stained glass piece, was done by Bianca, who did that beautiful video. It's called Imagine Peace. Bianca's, you know, from Santa Barbara, California. She's part of the Bridging Family crew. And her website is healingartscroatia.com, Healing Arts Croatia, because her homeland where she grew up was in Croatia. And here's what she says about producing this beautiful piece, Imagine Peace. A dream you dream alone is only a dream. A dream you dream together is reality. So very, very beautiful. So Bianca, thank you for making that incredible stained glass piece available for us and that video, and very beautiful. Thank you. So we're back with Ellen. So we were talking in the first section about, you know, your whole movement into healing and spiritual growth and love and healing yourself and healing the planet and all that. And now you're at the stage where you literally travel all over the world, making that available and being part of that movement that's happening, that grand evolution that, you know, I was talking about at the opening. And so how do you see us as a species moving more into that experience of that connectedness, that love, that through all the different spokes on the wheel that people are using all over, and you're using, you know, movement and music and massage and touch and all that?
One person at a time. From my understanding is that we are getting touched and less as we, technology, the way people live today. So one nervous system meeting another through the medium of touch has a palliative, a healing effect. So that's one way to do it, is just keep going around teaching people how to touch one another. And I think more effective for numbers is dance, which I mentioned before. There's a big move around, global move around the world right now to get people dancing. I know in one of the healing circles, it's to get 1 billion women on one day, and I don't know the date, dancing around the world for peace, for empowerment of women, for women stepping forward and really embodying themselves and becoming proactive in their own behalf. And once we get the feet moving and the breath going and the music happening, transformation's relatively easy, a slipping across that portal or through that doorway. Something as simple, I put on a pair of 3D glasses last week and went to an art show in Venice, California, and then walked out of the art show down the street with these 3D glasses on, and somehow through technology embedded in the lens was a heart. And so every light that I saw was one or two or 20 or 50 hearts. And the two other adults that I were with, all of us were over 40 and have very serious jobs during the day. And we, for 3 hours, did nothing but laugh and envision possibility for how something this simple, this inexpensive, could take us from having serious conversations into just laughter. And laughter is one of the great healing modalities on the planet. Energetically, with sound, that much energy and vibration moving through the physical body heals in and of itself. So how to get me and anyone else I might be with from taking everything too seriously to being able to find the pleasure, pleasure is one of my words, is how do we bring pleasure back into being okay? In a lot of the world, it's not. Simple pleasure through the senses. I work with essential oils. There are 200, only 200 plants, trees, roots, flowers that from which one can extract or distill the essence of that plant to be useful for humans. And it helps us reestablish our symbiotic relationship with nature, with the planet on which we are embodied. And so whether it's through that medium, all plant oils have a vibration, a higher vibration, some more than others. And they are aligned with the chakras, with the Indian understanding of how energy moves through the body, or through the meridians of Chinese medicine. And whether we take them in through the skin, through transdermal, that's through the skin, and use them as food for our bodies, or whether we take them in through scent, through smell, or we might take them in through a spa treatment with sea salt, again, that's through the skin, or we might eat them in food. We might grow plants, grow certain herbs, or you can use an essential oil, say the oil of peppermint, organic peppermint, a couple of drops under the tongue, will move through the system in 1 minute. And if one has an upset stomach, in most cases, it'll be gone. So learning what's healing, you know, learning about higher vibration, whether it's through sound or oils or touch or music or breath or putting on 3D glasses, and then sharing that in whatever way is appropriate. Is that answering a question? I've forgotten what the question was by now.
It was a brilliant question. I think you mostly answered. No. and do you see, as you travel the world, more and more people becoming enlivened to seek this joy, this simple pleasure, this connection, this experience of love for each, you know, for all of us, and a breakdown of countries and states and religions and all the things that helps seemingly separate us?
One thing I've noticed that's quite positive in this regard is the return of organic gardening, the return of people whose farms and lands were used for other purposes, perhaps maybe cattle ranching, are now going back to herbs. And in Indonesia, this is true. All along the east coast of the U.S., where I'm from, when I go to farmers markets, which is my habit to buy first there, amazing amount of return of the youth, the young people, you know, under 30, of their family lands to growing either herbs or food. So those have a higher vibration than something coming from the store in a can or the freezer case, or anything that's processed. So I see that as very hopeful. And the internet, in the old Native American prophecy from the Hopis and the Esalen Indians, there was prophesied that there would become a great spider would wrap its web around the earth, and that this web would have the potential for healing and reconnecting the peoples. And so that has come true now. And I see that a move toward peace or toward healing or toward wholeness, the good news is now traveling on the internet, not just through the media, that we don't rely on the media anymore to give us news, that social networking, your show, there are a number of shows now that are spreading positive news, and that even registration in my programs, someone can Google healing Bali and find me, and therefore end up in a program where before that might have never happened. So there's great hope, I think, through the right use of the internet.
Mm-hmm. And you find that these particular things, all these types of spokes on the wheel to get us to that center, that love, that healing, have the potential to open those doors, to raise the vibration, to bring us into portals of greater and greater expansion.
Yes. I think more and more people are waking up to what has been both ancient, that many of the practices that people are rediscovering, such as sound healing, has been around since the first sound. And sound is what created the universe, according to some traditions. So whether it's ancient being rediscovered or some new way being uncovered of how to connect the dots literally, that comprise who we are, or the connect the dots between you and me, yes, I see increased hopefulness and more occurrences of it. The programs that I offer, there are now more and more people doing them. You know, that this is a popular way to earn a living, offering retreats that allow the teacher to participate and that we're not in an overly lit room. We may be outside in nature receiving all the vibrations from nature. And that the number of people wanting to do this, following their bliss, as Joseph Campbell, one of the great sages of the last century, who recognized what was common in spiritual traditions around the world and was recognized in his lifetime for his gift, said, follow your bliss. You know, after his mountains of research and all the papers he had written and the recognition he received, if he had one quote that was his on his gravestone or on his ash urn that he was known for, was follow your bliss, do what you love. And I see that happening more and more in my profession as people discover the pleasure of sharing all these sensing modalities, breath, sound, good food, you know, eating healthy food, eating food with a higher vibration, which keeps us out of the doctor's office so much, that we are learning to practice preventative care through the pleasure of eating alive and well food. That's growing. I don't think it's just within the fringe culture that I might have been associated with. It seems to be on the grocery shelves of most stores now, in the refrigerator containers where we're eating more living, high vibration foods.
Why don't you talk more to follow your bliss and what that means to you and how, you know, we talk about it as service and how important it is, but in a way,
right,
it's the same kind of thing.
Right.
And how service lining up with your destiny, there's such a balance and a harmonizing effect about that.
Mm-hmm. Bliss has a close relationship with pleasure. So doing what brings me pleasure, which I never thought I could earn a living or support myself dancing and especially singing, because I had a belief that my voice was not a singing voice. And somewhere along the way, I sang as part of developing myself. And when I saw myself recorded singing, I actually fell in love with myself in a new way, because I made myself vulnerable. And I was, I could say, adorable. You know, there was something in my vulnerability and unskilled voice, right, but real, that helped me realize that everybody has that voice. And so that's one of the great pleasures I have. It's not a big seller, come learn to sing. Most people stay home. But the ones that do venture forth and find themselves, just like I did, actually singing a cappella and being recorded, most people fall in love with themselves in a new way and then are empowered to go out and share that. So that's something I never would have dreamed up in 100 years, in 1,000 years, in my earlier life, because of my belief system and my youthful experience being the opposite of that. And as you mentioned earlier in my intro, that one of the programs that I offer is your body is a musical instrument. And so it's whether touching the body or sounding or singing, that we're tuning up to become part of the holy band. One of the quotes I like, it's my quote, is we are facets in the great diamond of humanity. And in polishing our facets so we can truly shine, that tuning the instrument is one of the ways to do that, through movement, through sound, through touch. And as we take off the layers of contraction and holding and self-judgment or criticism, we do begin to shine. We become ageless, timeless creatures that are a reflection of the light that's coming forth from the sun, from above, from the great crystal that is part of what how humanity is reflected in the world. So bliss, for me has been finding those ways, those doorways, those pathways. I can wake up and think, oh my goodness, I might rather not go dance this morning at 7 o'clock, but I'm on the docket. I better get up and go lead this class. So I walk in and I begin the practice. Maybe I have the music of nature, maybe I have recorded music. And then once I begin the practice, and these other people who've come to engage in it actually do what I ask them to do for the most part, I give a lot of permission, invite curiosity, and literally within minutes, I'm transformed. And as I transform in the practice, so are the others. And I fall in love with the practice of dancing as a practice, a wellness practice for mind, body, spirit, of sweating to detox physically. That's the best detox we're given. It's natural. We're supposed to do it according to the experts 3 times a week to keep the system healthy. It's supposed to sweat and to use something as pleasant for most people as free-form dance to do that. Then I know that I don't have to go make myself do it in some other way. So I practice falling in love with what I do over and over again. The burnout rate for a professional body worker who gives 5 sessions a day, 5 days a week, is frequently 2 years. That's it. They injure themselves doing something, and I've been doing that now for over 25 years, being a professional body worker. I diversified, and now I teach. I do other practices. But I fall in love every time I lay my hands on someone and truly become present. And I receive joy and pleasure, as do they. Whether it's the simplest form or whether I've gotten quite elaborate and do a lot of movement, I may sound during it or sing to someone, that through combining these elements, that both tuning the musical instrument and dancing with and on the body. That's another one of my programs, where as I move around the table, dancing with this body, that the person receiving feels as if they've been danced with. So again, pleasure. And that in this moving meditation practice that involves touching, this is an hour to an hour and 15 minutes to an hour and a half of uninterrupted. There are no breaks, there are no stopping, that this is an ongoing, contactful meditation practice of what I'll call Holy Communion. And since I know that in my lifetime, I might have 10,000 of these sessions, max, that's probably about my capacity to give these sessions, that when someone actually shows up for a session, that this is a unique moment, given there are 7 billion people on the planet, that this is one very special occurrence. And if I can show up for it, that a precise moment of healing, whether it's spiritual, emotional, psychological, whether a physical illness goes, that I'm a medium of energetic exchange, that I'm not the healer. I don't get an ego blast from this, that the degree of openness between me and the person is dependent on both of us. If they're not open, then no amount of anything I do is going to do it. If I'm not open, they can be an open vessel. So it takes both of us, and we become a medium of energy exchanging. It's like infinite quantum figure eight movement of energy. And I leave the session as fulfilled as they do.
And
I'm not depleted. Right. Yes, I am not depleted as a result of this, if what I've just described is happening. So that brings me great pleasure, and it's another version of following my bliss.
That's beautiful, surprisingly enough. We're really coming to the end of the show, and we're ending it on Follow Your Bliss, so it's very cool. So if anybody wants any information about Ellen, Moving Ventures, all the workshops all over the world, in Indonesia, in Croatia, you know, please call me, Alan, 805-687-2053. If you want any information about the art project, International Healing Art Project, go to heaventoearthart.com. Everyone is welcome. Please join us. We love you. Good night. God bless you. Thank you for coming.